concussion. Oh, you miss my touching. Show me something. Give me more than one thing. I need more than less than I do. Say you're a good guy. Make me believe it. Don't wanna hear it. I wanna see it. See how.
Like It or Not, with Benjamin Dixon, starts now.
Welcome to Like It or Not, where we're free to tell the truth and not care who doesn't like it. I want to begin this morning with the airstrikes that the Biden administration conducted in Syria. There is a clip from Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin that I want us to consider before we begin this conversation, but there is a consistency. There is a consistency in American foreign policy, and that consistency transcends every administration. No matter which administration is your favorite, which one you hate the most, there is always a consistent trend in every single administration, and that is one of war. That is one of dropping bombs across the Middle East and in the global South. But before we get into that, let's take a listen in to Lloyd Austin as he explains why they conducted these strikes.
We're very deliberate about our approach, as you would expect us to be. We allowed and encouraged the Iraqis to investigate and develop intelligence, and that was very helpful to us in refining the target. And let me just finally say that I'm really proud of the men and women in our force who carried out the strike. As you would expect, they performed in a very professional manner, and we're grateful for their service.
Can you say why this was important to do, Mr. Secretary, and was this your recommendation?
It was my recommendation. As we said a number of times, we will respond on our timeline. And once again, we want to be sure that of the connectivity and want to be sure that we had the right targets.
When did the President authorize the strikes?
It was today, yes.
It was today. Was it this morning? Did
you
relate? Yes,
it was this morning. That's all I'm going to say, guys.
That's good. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Now, I want you to keep in mind that these strikes, the justification for these strikes includes the missile strikes against U.S. contractors, civilian contractors in the region, in Syria. This is not, however, the first time that a sitting president struck Syria so quickly and so early in their administration. You will remember in 2017, Donald Trump conducted airstrikes against Syria. His justification at the time was because of the chemical attack conducted by Bashar al-Assad during the Syrian civil war, which is continuing to happen as we speak, the Syrian civil war. I want to play, though, a clip from 2017. This is not a clip from Donald Trump. This is a clip from Brian Williams of CNN, of MSNBC, rather. And I want you to listen to the language and the energy and the propaganda as it pertains to the United States military-industrial complex that comes not only from Fox News, but even your favorite MSNBC. Take a listen to Brian Williams as he justifies the 2017, or he stands in awe of the 2017 strike against Syria.
go into greater detail, we see these beautiful pictures at night from the decks of these two U.S. Navy vessels in the Eastern Mediterranean. I am tempted to quote the great Leonard Cohen, "I'm guided by the beauty of our weapons." And they are beautiful pictures of fearsome armaments making what is for them a brief flight over to this airfield. What did they hit?
Okay, I want to tread carefully here just for a few minutes, and then afterwards, I'm not going to care. If it was wrong underneath the Trump administration, it's wrong underneath the Biden administration. Two different conversations that we're going to have simultaneously here. How media is complicit with it, and the media doesn't care who's doing the bombing. The media doesn't care who's conducting the strikes. The media is complicit with it because if you look at their advertisers for MSNBC, some of their advertisers include defense contractors, defense organizations, defense outfits that get billions of dollars every single year. So the media is going to be just fine and stand in awe of the beauty of our weapons, which is the most sociopathic thing I think I've ever heard. And it's been 2020. We've gone through 2020, but I digress. I want to also point to the hypocrisy of political leaders, because at the time, Donald Trump was lambasted, rightfully so, for that attack. In fact, the press secretary, the current sitting press secretary for the United States of America, for Joe Biden, Jen Psaki, she even called out Donald Trump at the time. I want to bring her tweet up on the screen. She said, I'm struggling with this because the hypocrisy is the thing for me. It's the hypocrisy. This is what she said. Also, what is the legal authority for the strikes? This is 2017. Assad is a brutal dictator. Yes, he is. But Syria is a sovereign country. Yes, they are. And so if Jen Psaki, the sitting press secretary for Joe Biden, thought in 2017 when Donald Trump conducted airstrikes for the purposes of retaliating against Bashar al-Assad because he conducted chemical strikes against his people, I'm sorry, that's a far greater justification than what we conducted this strike for this last night. Because last night, we're conducting it in retaliation for strikes against contractors. Contractors who are paid top dollar to go over there and conduct military exercises, conduct military events, to do things on behalf of the United States military. They're called contractors, but they are working on behalf of our Defense Department. Finally got it out. We conducted military strikes last night in retaliation for the Iranian-backed militias who retaliated against us. The real question is, why the hell is America still in these regions? You want to know why? Because defense contractors got to get paid, y'all. Defense contractors have to drop these bombs somewhere. If it was bad underneath Trump, it most certainly has to be bad now. And if we can't carry that moral consistency across political lines, then what good are we as human beings? What good are we as human beings if we can criticize Jen Psaki, if we can criticize Donald Trump? I really wonder if, matter of fact, I almost would guarantee you that they're not going to pull her out today. They're going to have the deputy press secretary out there today, because Jen Psaki is going to have to justify why it was wrong underneath Donald Trump, but it's okay underneath the Biden administration. There is a consistency that goes and transcends across every single administration. And the only thing that is consistent in this country, it's not whether or not we're going to take care of the people. No, it's not whether or not we're going to bail out the American people. No, it's not whether or not we're even going to do what's in the best interest of the people of this country. No, it is the consistency in our foreign policy and our desire as a nation to use the overwhelming majority of our tax dollars to drop bombs across the globe. If you can't see it and you can't bring yourself to hold each administration accountable for what they have done across the globe, then you're complicit with this. And forgive the accusatory tone this morning, but as we go through the rest of the stories this morning, you're going to see very clearly that we got plenty of money for bombs. We have plenty of dollars for war, but we can't feed the poor. James, take us to a quick break. When we come back, we're going to reset. We'll discuss this a little bit more, but then I also want us to discuss the fact that on the same night that we decided to drop bombs, they decided not to give working people $15 an hour, minimum living wage. We'll be right back after this.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, people, and welcome again to Like It or Not. It is your boy, DJ Exclusive, James Bob Williams. You know me as her. Just here, make sure we get y'all with the good hits, good music. Happy Friday to you all, and welcome, welcome, welcome. Shout out to everybody that's joining us this morning in the chat room. Glad to see you. It's time to get it, make it do what it do, y'all. So I hope you're ready. Let's go. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Matt. Hey, I see you, Alicia. Good morning, I see you. Good morning, Mama. I see you down there in the chat room. Good morning. Can't keep up, got them looking drained. Now they walking up, trying to put the face to the name. Pull up and I skirt, and I'm swerving. If a n- try to holler, she gon' curve. Dang, you can hear. We came from under buzz like a Persian. We
Fair girl, good morning, good morning. Rapping like a Esther, good morning. I see y'all. Good morning, y'all.
So it's square like Irving. Yeah, we grew up in the hood, no suburbans. If I say I need my money, then it's urgent. Yeah, yeah, they want me to quit. Yeah, they want me to shift. But as long as I'm alive, we gon' keep on making hits. Why they steady shooting bricks? Man, it's lit. Yeah, it's lit. Me and Dale back to back, and yeah, I'm dishing the assist.
Brenda, good morning, good morning.
With the lame man. Always gonna be reaching for they hit. Smoking like a clip. They could never catch me slipping. Every time your girl around, she be watch the way I'm dripping. Drippin'. Try your luck. Test me in again. We let it rain. Please don't start us up. Got that black and white. They ain't gang. Mr. Officer, please don't search us. We don't got a thing. Tell her park it up. Then that be poking out them jeans. I've been sparking.
Melanie, good morning, ma'am. Good morning.
The flame hurt you parking up. It's the wrong tree. I got the strength. Yeah, I'm charging up. They can't keep up. Got them looking drained. Now they walking up. Trying to put the face.
Magdalene Moon, good morning. I see you.
With the best though, that's a major key, that's a chess mo. I'm your favorite G, I think it's best, yo. Stop with all the grilling, I'm on jet fuel. Taking off, clear the runway, now they cannot clip my wings. Yeah, they suck, they ain't homie, they ain't even
Dude, good morning, good morning, Latif, good morning.
No one what they see, what it costs to get flee, but this style ain't free. It's that swag, just that splash, one wrong move, that's do the dash, keep a stash, just in case they tryna flash. Never lag, we don't slack, tell her eyes running back. I don't brag, I'm relaxed, I'm not in all of that, yeah. It's really just the fam and my dogs.
Catherine, good morning.
I ain't in all that chatting, not at all, not at all. Yeah, I put that on the squad, we been not you going hard. We on deck, please don't make them. Go and try your luck, test me in again, we let it rank. Please don't start us up, got that black and white, they ain't gang. Mr. Officer, please don't search us, we don't got a thing. Tell her park it up, then that be poking out them jeans up.
If I do have time, we appreciate your super chat, son. Thank you so much. Gail, good morning. I appreciate that love, Gail. So welcome back to the screen. Welcome back to the screen, Benjamin Dixon and our sister Rebecca. Oh, it's Cameroon and going on this morning. That's cute.
That's what I said, right? No, I told you.
Go, yeah, you heard it. So yeah, y'all playing. Don't try to set me up for none of that. Don't try to. Y'all already have me. Like I was complaining. Y'all already have me outside of the club in the line. Okay.
You can't get in.
What you say, Dwayne? How you gonna hate from outside the club? You can't even get in.
You can't even get in.
Couldn't even get in. That's not fair, y'all. Don't do it again. Look, I was like, I know him inside. Can you get the manager? Can you? No. It was like the black version of Karen back at the club.
And we wouldn't let you in.
Can you get the manager?
We would not let you in until you went and put on some maroon and gold. That said, listen, welcome back. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. And we had to start with the breaking news of the airstrikes out of Syria, because it's just man, we spending, you know, every bomb we drop over there is like $50,000, sometimes even worse than that. It is so much money in the military industrial complex. And honestly, I think these presidents all the way across the board are scared. I think they're afraid to stand up to the military-industrial complex. You got to think about it. Like we spend hundreds of billions of dollars every single year, and we increase that budget every single year. So you got to think about these defense contractor organizations, like they these companies, right? These for-profit companies that the Pentagon outsources to, they get billions quarterly. I mean, the most obscene profits they get. And can you imagine, there's a mouse on my head, by the way, can you imagine a president coming in and messing with that money? I honestly think at a certain extent that these presidents are afraid to tell these people no, to tell the defense contractors, to tell the Department of Defense, to tell these industries, absolutely not. We're not going to drop these bombs. But anyway, welcome back. Good morning, James, Rebecca. How y'all doing? I got a whole lot more to talk about. I want to pull up a tweet or two.
Ask us a question and go straight to the tweet. How y'all doing?
This tweet is.
You was ready to answer, right? Bubba?
Listen,
you
like, right? You saw
it's a flow
unknown and everything. Like,
that's not a flow. If you and you know me and Bubba be ready to answer, and you was just like, "How y'all doing?" Anyway,
we got a delay over here.
You gotta get in there. So I'm gonna try it again. How y'all doing this morning?
We're doing good. Are we doing
that's
that?
Too Look,
is it too much? Look, are we having a conversation? We're just like, it's hey, we're good. Go ahead.
No, just hey, okay. Good. Let's try it again. You're good. Okay. Well, we'll be even better after we look at these tweets. Take a look at this tweet from Amy Siskind. She said, "It's so different having military action underneath Biden. No middle school level threats on Twitter. Trust Biden and his team's competence." And
that's how she sounds.
And then somebody else said, "I like it. When you swat a mosquito, you don't call a press conference to talk about it. You just do what needs to be done and move on." Let me go right to this next one. Next one from some random. I don't know who this is, but this is just the mindset. Such a quiet attack. No drama. No TV coverage of bombs hitting targets. No comments on how presidential Biden is. What a difference. This is
Here's the thing.
This is crazy. Oh,
these people are literally living in... You know how, like, on WandaVision, did y'all play the song without me? But do you know how, like, on WandaVision, they start off the show in black and white? They're just living in this alternate universe, right? That's how I feel like these Biden supporters. And here's the thing. I'm not saying that Biden can't get right. But what he's showing us right now, the fluff. Okay, all of that, like, relax, guys. It's okay to hold people accountable. I know it wasn't normal for years and years in the history of the presidents that we've had. But now you guys have voices. Stand in your voice. Practice with me. Biden ain't doing nothing. Practice, say it with me. Biden ain't doing nothing. At least none of the promises that he's already said that he would put in immediately, he hasn't done. And it's okay, guys. It's okay to hold him accountable, because that may cause him to change his ways. Like, that may cause him, probably, maybe, I don't know, but it may cause him to do something different. You guys supporting him and saying, oh my God, this feels like a fresh breath of fresh air. It feels so great. And Biden is president and I love it. Like, what else, sis? Because the people who look like me, the people from, you know, Haiti, because it's just a hand. There's no nail here. But the people from Haiti, the people from Haiti, you know, my folks are sitting there like, Biden is doing nothing. This is him going into people's playgrounds, people's homes, people's livelihoods, and saying he's going to protect and help and doing not nothing. So everyone who's floating on flowers because they know Biden's policies would protect them, but they don't understand how it hurts other people's, please sit this one out with your commentary. Mm.
Right. Yeah, look, Rebecca. Ben. I feel you. I think Ben is frozen somewhere. Like he, oh, there he goes. Oh,
okay, good. Got it.
Wait,
great.
Wait, he's frozen. Look, Rebecca.
He really is frozen. He's really and I was frozen. Like, why? Is he looking at me like, girl, shut up and let me talk? That's how I felt about that.
Somebody like, needs to screenshot that, being like, this mother.
Somebody screen. Look, everybody screenshot it right now. Everybody, look, and now I'm getting a close up. But
y'all
no,
bear with us. We
no,
just have a few technical difficulties. Okay, we got it. We under control. It's okay.
We got it under control. But Bubba, what do you think about all the people who are literally looking at Joe Biden, seeing what he's doing, like watching him not go through with the promises, whether it comes to the checks? You know, when I say checks, I'm talking about the stimulus checks. I need my stimulus check. Yes, that check. The you know, the him stepping into Haiti's issues, promising them one thing, not doing another, and all these people adding on to him and saying, but he's doing this, but he's so calm. What do you think about that?
You know, I really think it's a bunch of BS, you know, because just like you said, he's not following through with everything that he promised. And he needs to, I know last night I saw in the news that already he pushed something out that he said he was going to do in the first 100 days he was in office.
Yeah.
He's already pushing stuff back. That's not what we wanted, sir.
We need certain
things immediately, okay?
Yeah.
And we're still just, we pussyfooting around, like my dad used to say.
Yeah.
To get it together, look, y'all.
Get it together. And then with Kamala Harris, you know, from the minimum wage, I know that we were supposed to go into that, the minimum wage situation. What are we supposed to do with that? He said that he would raise it to a certain amount. He said that he would assist us in that. We can't even, now with the number that he proposed is something that we can't even really work with. Was it $15? We can't really work with, but we'll take because it's better than what we have. But now it's looking like that may not happen. That's another promise. And then Kamala Harris, where is she in the midst of all of this? What is she saying? What is she doing? I know that I seen last night, maybe I missed something. I know that I seen last night that a lot of people were saying like, hey, you know, we can't trust her. But how do you feel in this moment with the minimum wage situation? Because, you know, we still in corporate. We still in corporate.
And honestly, Rebecca, I mean, like, even with the salary that I'm making, it's still not enough.
Yeah.
And so I can only imagine you telling people that they're going to $15 an hour, not going to do anything. And then you're talking about the compromise is maybe $10 an hour. What the hell is that going to do? What is
$10?
I was making $10 an hour when I was in high school. That was in 97.
What the hell is that? You were in high school making $10. You know how much I was making? Do you know how much I was making out there in Florida, West Palm Beach, at the JCPenney's at the Palm Beach Mall? I was making $6.75. I was a kid, though. $6.75. I was a kid. And I was the lead cashier. The lead cashier. I thought I had the best, you know, the best position. And then when I got older, I thought $10. And I was in my 20s, y'all. And I thought...
Right.
Because they made me believe that $10 an hour was everything. They made me believe that $13 an hour was everything. Mm. Now I'm really living life, and I see that rent is going up. Mm. I see that the cost of food is going up. I see that car payments ain't the same, baby. I see that, like, gas is always, like, fluctuating, right? And my car takes 93. You know that's expensive gas. You know, that ain't 87. I wish. But... I don't have a Mercedes, but anywho, look, don't put that out there because they know that I'm out here working corporate. Can't have no Mercedes working corporate and complaining. Working it don't corporate. Work like that. But yes, all of that to say, like, I see that all of these things are happening. I see that, you know, how can we, $15 an hour ain't going to cut it for me. It's not going to help me pay my rent. It's not going to help me feed the kids I ain't got. It's not going to help me help my family like I'm supposed to.
Right.
It's not going to help me live. And but what do? We make sure that we put our bills in order to match our payday. And if it doesn't, we'll risk getting that late fee and just to be able to pay our bills because we're getting paid so low. I don't understand why they why this is math to them. I don't get it. If things are going up as far as utilities, as far as housing, as far as basic living needs, if those are going up, why can't the minimum wage go up too? It makes sense. It's not rocket science.
Oh my gosh, right.
It's not rocket science.
It seems like it is. You know why they don't care about it? Because it doesn't affect them. And they rich as hell just sitting up there on the hill just thinking like, oh, they'll be okay. Give them $15 an hour. They'll be all right. But now, the more right. so, they want it to be where the business themselves decide how much the minimum wage should be. No, hell no. Because those people know better either.
Yeah. They're going to make sure you stay down in these areas. They're going to make sure, you know, the people in the business, they want to make sure, listen, sis, we gave you benefits. All right. And I get it. You know, you're working like a slave, but you're our slave. And I say that, and don't get offended, people in the audience. I say that because that was said to me in my corporation. You're working like a slave. You're working like a robot. I know it sounds crazy, but you're our robot. You're our slave. It's okay. It's okay. You know, we give you benefits for it. We pay you nothing but give you benefits for it.
So, and that's supposed to make me happy? This is giving me benefits? Man, what if I don't go to the doctor except once a year? Sometimes I might have it like that. So your benefits
really don't mean nothing. What if you don't go to the doctor really at all?
Do I get that money back? Do I get a residual check?
No, you don't. Nope. They continue to steal. Yes, they continue to steal, kill, and destroy. And I say all this to say, y'all, look more into Biden. Understand what Biden is doing and not doing. Hold him accountable. This is important. You people that are fluffing and under these tweets, and I remember I used to be one of those people not understanding what's going on and how it's affecting me and the people around me and how I am able to take care of those around me. It's like prohibiting me to do so because Biden is just talking in this nice voice and he's relatable, but he's not doing what he promised. And it's important for us to hold him accountable. Let's raise that minimum wage. We cannot sleep and we cannot go to and be okay with it not being raised after he has literally ran his campaign on that. We're not doing that. And on that note, let's go ahead. Yeah, look, Sleepy Joe, Robinette. Let's go ahead and go to break. Let's see if we can pull Ben out of the trenches because now he's outside the club and he can't get in.
He's outside the club. All right? He can't get in.
More like
that's
it or
I'm
not right
being
after
a
this.
DJ. All right, y'all. We hope y'all are enjoying the show thus far while we're working through some of these technical difficulties, y'all. But make sure that you stay tuned. We got more Like It or Not coming up. Had to hit y'all back with a throwback jam. It's Friday, so make sure we play some good music for y'all that's gonna keep you crunk today. Got some good tracks coming up, so make sure that you stay tuned.
Trying to find something while you don't trust me. I got this feeling I'll be much better on my own now. There you go. With apologies, it's alright. You don't mean it. And I don't wanna try no more now. It's too late. I don't wanna hear you say you're sorry.
Morning, y'all. Make sure that y'all are hitting that like button. Hit that like button. Hit that like button, y'all. Hit that like button. Somebody said, give Ben some of those DJ crates so he can get in club. Unfortunately, I don't carry crates no more. Everything is on my laptop. So, Ben, come on in and carry the laptop. We'll get you in the club, okay?
Give you everything I have, still it ain't enough. I got this. I'll be much better on my own. There you go. With apologies, it's alright. You don't mean it. And I don't wanna try no more now. It's too late.
Lisa Noel. Not the happy breakup song.
I don't wanna hear no more excuses. It's alright. See, I'ma walk away cause I'd rather be alone now.
Good morning.
I got it.
line. Good morning. Tomorrow I will find out and I will let you know, okay? Black Dragon, what's up, brother? Literally, my brother, what's going on? Kimberly Frazier, good morning, ma'am. Happy Friday to everyone.
Losing our control. Henny with the shoulder. I've been on a roll. Life been taking toll. I just wanna roam. I've been ready for them bad days. Tryna take it slower. Party on occasion. I should ease the weight off my shoulders. Yeah. I said we only getting older. Yeah. And tell me, are you coming over? I need to know. Is you falling through?
Tell Perfect time to tell y'all about the Like It or Not app. Make sure that you download the Voices by Action Sprout app so you can connect to the Like It or Not group. That way you can send us any videos, artwork, pictures, whatever you may have, and we can get it played on the air. Also with the Like It or Not, well, the Voices app, we can push out information to you guys as well too. So make sure you get that downloaded on your phone. Download, search for Voices by Action Sprout. Voices by Action Sprout. Use our group code 213-756, 213-756, and you can be connected to Like It or Not.
Lately I've been low down, losing all control, I admit it. All this shit is here, my limits. This might be all day, yeah, let me finish. I get it, I know you tease me. Tell me for the leave, only for the eve. See you searching for the meaning. Hate the way we treat you.
Seven, why sweetheart, you I appreciate that super chat. Baby, happy Friday you to you.
Know you want that repeat. Yeah, ain't no way around it. We got a danger about us. You got your way about you. Not much to say about it. Still have your way around me. They say we're something special. Is it better when we left it? All this inside of my head. Know when you're ready, I just wanna know.
Tell me it's the real thing. Tell me it's the real thing.
Alright, Danny, don't talk too much now.
I just wanna know.
I just wanna know.
Tell me it's the real thing. Tell me it's the real thing. I just wanna know. Tell me it's the real thing.
Cause
I don't want us to go. No, no I don't
I'm
want
still
us
in a grooving,
to go.
Girl.
Okay, I'm like, y'all really gotta leave me out here. It's okay.
We ain't gonna leave you hanging, sis. Outside the club.
Cause I've been outside the club now. Look, that's what God don't plan. He loved me. Look, when people look, when bad stuff happened to people, and you know, you just had that bad thing happen to you, but that person was talking about you, you'd be like, God don't play about me.
See, God don't play about me at all.
The Lord don't play about me, right? But let's get into some news while we figure out what Ben got going on. Let's talk about some Republican transphobia. That's not anything new now. We know that's something that's still a thing.
Right.
That's been a thing. Now, the past few days have been full of Republican transphobia. Let's take a look at just a few examples from the last 24 hours of bigotry. As the House of Representatives debated the Equality Act, which would make it illegal to discriminate against LGBTQIA Americans, Representative Marie Newman, a Democrat from Illinois, decided to hang up a trans pride flag outside her congressional office. Representative Newman did this because her own daughter is trans and she wanted to remind her office neighbor. Listen to who her office neighbor is, y'all. Georgia Republican Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene. She's still something in the House. She's still something in Congress. Let's put that in mind. After we felt like we silenced her, she's still here acting up. This is where. Here's the tweet that Newman posted. She said, our neighbor, Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene, tried to block the Equality Act because she believes prohibiting discrimination against trans Americans is disgusting, immoral, and evil. Thought we'd put up our transgender flag so she can look at it every time she opens the door. In response, Marjorie Taylor Greene tweeted this. Our neighbor, Representative Marie Newman, wants to pass the so-called Equality Act to destroy women's rights and religious freedoms. Thought we'd put up ours so she can look at it every day, every time she opens the door. So Newman recapped the whole exchange with Marjorie Taylor Greene on CNN. Let's take a look.
Congresswoman, thank you very much for being here.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
How did this fight with Marjorie Taylor Greene start exactly?
Well, it was never meant to be a fight. It was a statement I felt very necessary. You know, this woman has supported insurrection. She voted against the election. She believes in a wide variety of conspiracy theories. She has been called out any number of times. But on this issue yesterday, she tried to block the Equality Act. And I felt as though she needed to hear from us. And what I mean by that is that I just wanted to make a statement so that she sees LGBTQ plus people. And so the symbolism was simply to put the flag out there so she has to see our community every day. You know, I'm immensely proud of my daughter. And that's all anyone is asking for, is to be treated as anyone else. And that's what I want Representative Greene to see.
So when you walked outside of your office and you saw that sign that she put up that said there are two genders, male and female, trust the science, what were your thoughts?
Well, two things. I thought, wow, she's got a lot of time on her hands because she would have to go get that printed and decide that this is the right thing to do. So it kind of wild in, on a bunch of fronts. But, you know, further, what I would say is that she's welcome to her sign. No one's buying it. And that is not science.
Well, I mean, not only that, she now she likes science. I mean, this is the same this is the same congresswoman who proudly doesn't wear a mask in close confined quarters, as we saw, I believe, on January 6th. But
she's the scum of the earth. I'm sorry. Hi, Ben. Welcome back.
Yes, Marjorie Taylor Greene is a scum of the earth, and it's great to have you back, Benjamin Dixon. Let me get through the segment and we'll get you right in. So now that we've recapped some of the transphobia in the House, as we can see, especially by Rep. Marjorie Taylor Greene, who still seems to have a voice, let's take a look at the Senate. Rand Paul, Republican senator from Kentucky, was interviewing Biden's nominee for Assistant Health Secretary, Rachel Levine, who would be the first trans person to be confirmed by the U.S. Senate. Now, let's listen to this horrifying line of questioning.
Senator Paul.
Genital mutilation has been nearly universally condemned. Genital mutilation has been condemned by the WHO, the United Nations Children's Fund, the United Nations Population Fund. According to the WHO, genital mutilation is recognized internationally as a violation of human rights. Genital mutilation is considered particularly egregious because, as the WHO notes, it is nearly always carried out on minors and is a violation of the rights of children. Most genital mutilation is not typically performed by force.
Like straight up.
But as WHO notes, that by social convention, social norm, the social pressure to conform, to do what others do and have been doing, as well as the need to be accepted socially and the fear of being rejected by the community. American culture is now normalizing the idea that minors can be given hormones to prevent their biological development of their secondary sexual characteristics. Dr. Levine, you have supported both allowing minors to be given hormone blockers to prevent them from going through puberty, as well as surgical destruction of a minor's genitalia. Like surgical mutilation, hormonal interruption of puberty can permanently alter and prevent secondary sexual characteristics. The American College of Pediatricians reports that 80 to 95% of prepubertal children with gender dysphoria will experience resolution by late adolescence if not exposed to medical intervention and social affirmation. Dr. Levine, do you believe that minors are capable of making such a life-changing decision as changing one's sex?
Well, Senator, thank you for your interest in this question. Transgender medicine is a very complex and nuanced field with robust.
So Levine, as we see, has been subjected to repeat misgendering by Republican lawmakers and staff since her nomination, particularly during the lead up to the House passage of the Equality Act on Thursday. So finally, it was announced yesterday that Hasbro will begin selling potato. We're not going to go into that because I need to unpack this first.
Yeah.
What we just saw.
Yeah.
So what we just saw was abuse.
I'm glad.
Verbal abuse.
I'm glad abuse. Rand Paul's neighbor beat his ass.
That
I'm proud of that. The happiest moment of my political experience was when Rand Paul got his ass beat by his neighbor, because it takes a sick, twisted, demented piece of crap for you to intentionally frame this conversation and those lines of questioning in that way. And it's designed specifically to cause emotional harm to Dr. Levine and to the trans community in general. My only regret is that his neighbor didn't beat his ass twice. That's all I got to say about him.
So, yeah, it's crazy because you said you're glad that he got his behind beat. It's funny because that didn't stop him from doing what he did the other day.
So apparently it wasn't done well enough, because that is pure evil wrapped in being professional sounding with a suit and a tie and in the Senate. It is pure evil being forced through the American conversation by virtue of the Senate. So apparently he didn't learn his lesson well enough the first time. And apparently this is just something Republicans just don't get. And they're going to continuously doing these types of things. And I apologize for cutting you off again, Rebecca, but this dude right here, in this moment right here, shows you exactly how malicious they are. See, I don't care what people believe, what they want to do, what you want to preach your children, what you want to teach your children, what you want to go to church and do, but what you do not have the right to do is cause intentional harm to somebody and expect us to stand by just because you're a senator and say, oh, he's a senator. No, my dude. No, you're going to run up on the right one with your.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with everything you're saying. And I think so. The point I was trying to get to is he got his behind whooped, and then Marjorie Taylor Greene, they thought they laid the hammer on her as well. They thought they silenced her voice, but nothing seems to be stopping these Republicans. They will literally rise up from the dead and like try to attack, abuse, hurt people. My thing is, he looked at this trans woman and literally was stating these things, but looking her in her eyes and saying these things against her, knowing that she was trans. That's where my problem was. It's like, ma'am was so she was so upset. She took off her mask.
Her mask, right?
And was like, see, I'm about to risk it all because you trying it right now. You trying it. And let me show you, these hands still work, baby, no matter what. Hands is hands.
I was about to say, he was about to get that trans life for real, what you really want to know.
Hands are hands,
because
sweetie,
let me tell you, you got to catch you in the goddamn street. It's on.
Come on, man. Come on, man.
And that's the thing. And that's the thing. We look at these people and we hear these people, but they have the floor. They have the mics.
Right.
And that's what bothers me so much. We thought we silenced Marjorie Taylor Greene.
Oh,
man.
Yeah.
She came, you know, we thought we did. Now, I will say with Representative Marie Newman, I understand that Marjorie Taylor Greene is right across the way from her. And she wanted to put out, she said she wanted to make sure she put that out so that message can be heard. But this is sometimes too, I feel like we're, and I might be going another side of the whole conversation here, but this is sometimes I feel like we lean in to the wrong things. Put your flag out and just, that's what you're representing. That's it. Don't put it out to antagonize that crazy lady across the way, right? Because you know that she's going to start. And what happens? We start giving them attention. She was supposed to be silenced. She was not supposed to be a part of any of this. Like, we weren't supposed to be bringing up Marjorie Taylor Greene. We know that she's going to be dumb enough to go put this stuff out. We know. I know it hurts. I know it sucks having that person right across the way from you that disrespects your own daughter, right? What your daughter stands for, who your daughter is. I have neighbors who don't like me because of the way that I look. But you think I'm moving? I'm not, sweetie. I'm not moving at all. But I'm not going to keep acknowledging them either. Like, I'm going to keep living here normally, doing my thing, and you're just going to have to deal with it. We have other things to focus on. When we do stuff like this, we put this in the news cycle. We already know how terrible Marjorie Taylor Greene is. We know she's nasty. We know that she's a conspiracy theorist. We know what she stands for. But let's not give it any attention. Now what happens is we have this. She's in our news cycle. She's in our thinking process right now. She's in our conversation right now. So
I hear you. But like, for one congressperson to not be able to make their statement outside of their door without the other one, like, being the piece of scum of the earth, fecal matter that Marjorie Taylor Greene is. I mean, whether we can't make our decisions based on how bigoted and how reactionary the opposition is going to be, because that's what they're going to be anyway, right? Like, look at like Dr. Levine simply trying to get Senate confirmation. Her sheer, just pure existence, like the fact that she's alive and that she's a trans woman, and that was enough to elicit all of this barbarity from Republicans, right? So it's one thing, and I hear you in saying in terms of like antagonizing, but these bigots, you don't have to antagonize. They're just assholes. They're just evil, malicious, sadistic people who have no business in power. And it really speaks to how deranged this country is as a whole, because the reason they're in power is because they got like millions of other people who see the world exactly like they do. And so underneath this, we have a much bigger problem. And the much bigger problem is that there's an entire half of this country that revels in this bigotry. And whether or not we proactively make a statement or whether or not we just exist, they're coming after us anyway.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. But what I'm saying is, when you have, like, what Marie Newman said, Representative Marie Newman said, she knew what Marjorie Taylor Greene stood for. And she's like, let me just, you know, put this out of my door because XYZ. Just put it outside your door because you're representing your daughter. That's it. There's no reason. And that, now, it's a difference. It's a difference with Representative Levine sitting there and him literally looking at her and disrespecting her in that way. Like, she didn't know that was going to happen. She didn't know that she was going to be set up for that. She thought, like, this is going to be a different kind of situation. And he literally looked at her and like, you're trans and that's disgusting. Mm. You're trans and that's disgusting. She didn't know that was a setup. Now, this back and forth happening in Congress, there's so much more to be talked about. There's so much more to be doing. Now, on like I said, Representative Levine, like, Dr. Levine. That's trash. That's Rand Paul's trash. We know that. That's trash. But that was not expected. She was ready to be like, wait, first of all, respect me. Respect me. Now, in the Congress, like, things like that, the door-to-door, she's going to be putting up her sign. She's going to be putting up her sign. It's stupid. Like, we know who Marjorie, like I said, Marjorie Taylor Greene does not deserve any light anymore. We know that she's dumb. We know that she's trash. We know that she's scum. Like, it almost feels like high school at this point. But
that's what somebody literally tweeted. What's your boy name? Bakari Sellers from CNN said,
yeah, it feels
Congress
childish.
Is high school.
it's like me going to my locker and being like, look at that girl over there. She mad, but I'm gonna make her real mad. It's just like, no, like, we got so much more to really focus on at this point. That's how I feel.
Yeah,
about
that 15 an hour that I was my internet time.
Yeah, go ahead and speak on it because I know you was ready.
No. It's no. I mean, I missed the whole segment. Shout out to this. You know, if I clown FAMU internet, I'm gonna have to clown this Bethune-Cookman internet I got over here today. But
the Lord works in mysterious ways.
I almost said your mama. I forgot. What, I was like, but to the bigger point, man. The one thing I don't agree with people who say, and I don't know if this is what you're saying, Rebecca, but I did see this on Twitter all day yesterday. They were like, don't give her, Marjorie Taylor Greene, don't give her any air, any oxygen, don't let her grow.
Mm-hmm.
The trick is that they don't need us to give them air. They have millions of people and billions of dollars to do that. And so whether or not we talk about her or not, She's going to continuously rise in this country because there are millions of people who see the world just like she does. And so the question becomes is, do we sit back and say nothing because we don't want to give her oxygen, or do we give her hell every step of the way? Because it's not as though if we stop talking about her, she's going to go away. This is not like Candyman, like if you don't speak of her, she won't exist. No, this is she has billions of dollars behind her in this Fox News conservative ecosystem. And she's going to rise. And if we don't speak out and speak up every single chance, then she gets to rise unabated. She gets to rise without any challenge. So my thing is, we got to give them hell. We got to give them hell every step of the way.
So I hear you and I love you. I mean it. But
don't mean you're right.
It doesn't mean that you're right. You know, we can agree to disagree. So what I'm saying is it's not that. Marjorie Taylor Greene, yes, a million people may be behind her. We can't stop that. That's how it's always been, especially with white Republicans. And now, she's a whole Karen, okay? So people are going to support her. They are. That's just how it is. Now, us giving her light is a different story because remember Tommy? Was that her name? Tommy? I forgot her name.
Lorenzo, yeah. Yeah.
Lauren, I don't know, La Sienica. I don't know. Yes, her. Remember when she was literally like the thing? The thing. Like we always talked about her. We put her in the news cycles. That was it. She was always everywhere. Now it's kind of like when we just felt like, okay, girl, she's still probably being supported by so many millions of people, but she ain't that chick no more because people just said, okay, let's turn the lights off on her. Let's just do that.
Well, go ahead, finish that thought. I
feel like there's so much more that we can talk about. Yes. When she, like Rand Paul deserves to be dragged for what he said to that woman and how that whole play went out. But the high schoolness, the tit for tat that's happening inside Congress, especially against somebody that we just said that we would silence or, you know, not give any attention to just last month, we need to stick to that because there's so much other things, like I said, that we could talk about. Like you just said, $15 an hour, that's more of an issue that I would like to discuss, that I would like to see. And I'm not surprised at the trash that Marjorie Taylor Greene is doing or what she's saying or how she's being. That doesn't surprise me. We were upset about it already last month. Now, if she pulled what Rand Paul pulled, like going into the and attacking people and like she did on the street, or that deserves to be whatever. But the high school play, tit for tat across the way and da da da, I don't really like that's so gonna that's probably
she,
gonna happen
do you think
regardless.
She should not have put the flag out.
Who? No, that's not what I'm saying.
No, yeah,
let me tell you.
I'm asking, do you think she should not have put the flag out?
No, put your flag out. Do you? But the fact that she said I put it out because I know who's across the way. I knew that's what I was just about to say.
Yeah, and it's more like that. Like Rebecca said, that tit for tat, you know, is not warranted. Put the flag out. Don't say nothing. You ain't got to say nothing at all. The flag's going to speak for itself. So, but you put the flag out, and now you got to say, "I put it out because X, Y, Z. This person is across the hall."
But let's
now it's just like, okay, come on, what are you doing?
It's like, because now it's starting this war. But now you're on CNN and you're talking about this is what she did. Now you're talking about this is what she did, and it's just like we're kids right now. That's how I felt. That's what it gave me.
So, I want to make sure we got the order of operations right, because I may not have something in the proper order here. She put the flag out, and then Marjorie Taylor Greene responded, and then she went on to CNN to say all that she said. The clip we just played.
Is she
that
put the flag order? Out, and she said in that interview, "It's because I knew basically who was across the way. Like I knew that that's a difference. It's like but I put the response, my flag out because I'm representing my daughter. Period."
But the response from Marjorie Taylor Greene.
It was trash too.
Right. No, what I'm saying is she put the flag out. She did what you guys said, which is like, I put the flag out. Right. And then the immediate response after that was Marjorie Taylor Greene with her post. So I'm trying to see, like, you know, if this morning or last night she went on CNN and saying, well, I mean, I knew it was going to bother her, but she put the flag out anyway. That's, to me, that's not tit for tat. That's the CNN interview might be tit for tat, but she put the flag out and she put it there. And then she didn't say, I'm sure she didn't go. She didn't go next door and knock on Marjorie Taylor Greene's door and say, hey, come check out this flag. She put the flag out and Marjorie Taylor Greene did what she did. Had Marjorie Taylor Greene not done what she did, then there would be no response that had to be made.
You see, even this conversation that we're having bothers me right now, because it's like it's almost like stupid. It's tit for tat. Like, I don't agree with how why she put the flag out. Put your flag out because you want to represent your daughter and keep it at that. Your whole probably hallway is full of people who can't stand your the fact that your daughter is trans. It's going to be that, right? Just keep doing you. Let's keep doing you. I don't really care for the interviews that are because Marjorie Taylor Greene is probably going to pop up on Fox and talk about her situation. Yeah. To me, it's such a bigger conversation. And it's just the fact that, you know, there's people like Rand Paul who get to sit there and speak to this woman in the uttermost disrespect. She wasn't even expecting that. And you literally just give her the uttermost disrespect for who she is as a person. That was more of a thing to me. So
my thing is that maybe her CNN interview was tit for tat. Right. I'll give you guys both that. But her putting the flag out was not tit for tat. She put the flag out and the response came from Marjorie Taylor Greene, which created this whole situation. Right. It wasn't like a strike against her. It's another example. The reason I'm harping on this point is because it's another example of simply existing. If she put the flag out and never did another interview, Marjorie Taylor Greene would have came out and did the same thing. That's what I'm saying. Like, the response and the reaction from half of this country is always going to be evil and malicious when they see something that they don't like, or they see somebody who exists that they don't like. Like, I mean, literally, they could put out a Black Lives Matter flag, right? Or they can put out a Black Liberation flag and say nothing. And I guarantee you, Marjorie Taylor Greene and the rest of the, not just her, all the other Republicans are going to come out and make a big stink about it, to which there will become this, you know, this news cycle that we're talking about now. But my whole take is that it wouldn't have mattered. It wouldn't have. This is the response they would have gotten anyway, regardless. Because
so I agree with you. I agree with you 100% on that. But that's not what I'm saying. I'm not going to put my Black Lives Matter flag that I'm going to put outside my doors because I put it out for me, not because I know the lady across the street does not give a damn about me and I'm trying to start war with her. That's what I'm saying. That's the end of conversation at that point, because we're not going to agree at this point. But that's it, y'all. Do your job. Represent what you represent. Who gives a damn who's around you? You are meant to be in that space. You are meant to be in that place. And that's just that on that. And, live your life. Now, when somebody runs up on you in your face, disrespects you in your face, on like the ops come at you, it's a different story. And when they come knock on my door, when I'm playing my music, because I'm playing my music for me. I ain't playing it to disrupt them or to get them riled up, because I know they don't like the type of music that I play because another language is being played, or is being played by a Black woman. I play it because I want to, because this is my space, because that's what that is. I didn't play it because I knew it was going to annoy them because they don't like it. But when they come knock at my door, that's when you done step into my territory. And that's where the problem arises. And that's that on that.
Do I need to pull up over there, Rebecca?
You might need to. Look, you might need to.
She got more stories about that neighborhood acting crazy than a little bit. I don't know what side of Georgia she living on, but she ain't, she ain't living in Fulton County.
Let me pull up there. Let me bring my boys up there. Okay.
I know, my
that. Now I'm still a thug, girl. Don't get it twisted, girl.
They can't take that about you. It don't matter. People don't get that. No matter what you are, don't get it twisted, baby. These don't hands didn't work.
Let me tell you something, Dave. My favorite videos right now. My favorite. I watch fight videos. That's my thing. And that's my guilty pleasure. My favorite fight videos is when dudes be running up on gay brothers thinking gay brothers ain't got hands. That's my new favorite genre of video.
I can't lie. And I don't like watching fight videos, but you right, Ben.
And I just be sitting back and I just be waiting, because I'm like, you going to catch some real, and then pop out like a two-piece snack real quick. Dude thing, you know, dropping all kind of homophobic slurs and stuff. And next thing you know, he's picking his teeth up off the ground, right? That's my new thing. So yeah, pull up in that county. Pull up in that county that's north of south of, or west of, or east of.
Look,
or,
people will
it
find
ain't, let me tell you something.
Right.
It ain't our counties. She ain't living where we living, bro.
I'm not living where they're living. It's predominantly
not at all.
Blanco.
James, get us some quick music. We got a couple of more stories to come back to, and we have a couple of guests that we want to get to in this next hour of this thing that we're doing here, like it or not. You saw that? You saw that?
What is that?
I didn't say it. It almost.
I can't stand y'all. Hey, y'all, make sure that you download the Voices by Action Sprout app so you can connect with Like It or Not. What you need to do, you can scan either of the QR codes that are on the screen, be it you have the iPhone or an Android device, like I always say. What you want to do? Search for Voices by Action Sprout. Search for Voices by Action Sprout on your app store. And what you'll do, you enter our group code, which is 213-756. 213-756. And then you will be connected to the Like It or Not family, y'all. Come on, join in. Send us your pictures, your videos, and we will get those played on air, y'all. Let's get it. Let's go. Like It or Not.
You, me, yeah. I believe in you, me, yeah. Let's stay here for a lifetime underneath the moonlight. Cause I don't want us to go. No, I don't want us to go. Yeah, you could be my lifeline, you could be my sunshine. In a world so full of pain, can you make it go away? Used to be so sad that love was lost, but now it's here to stay. Yeah, I used to be uncomfortable, but look.
Shout out Goku! What's going on, sir?
Now I know you're the answer to my prayer. You and me must be right. Something's in the air, I can feel it now. You and me must do something right. We can't get enough of us. You and me every night, aiming for the stars with the love so bright. You and me must do something right. Baby, I believe in us. Sorry for the burden, sorry I was hurting. But my scars are almost healed. Yeah, my scars are almost healed. Yeah, I'm feeling like a child now. Everything's alright now. And it's all because of you. You made the flower in me bloom. Used to be afraid of everything, but now there's no more fear. Yeah, I used to let nobody in and hide my face with tears. But I was wrong, baby, now I believe. You and me must be right. Something's in the air, I can feel it now. You and me must do something right. We can't get enough of us. You and me every night, aiming for the stars with the love so bright. You and me must do something right. Baby, I believe in us.
Sydney Butler, good morning. All right, y'all, coming back to the screen. Like It or Not, Benjamin Dixon.
Welcome back to Like It or Not, where we're free to tell the truth and not care who doesn't like it. We're joined by Representative Omari Hardy. He is a state representative for Florida's 88th district. Now, you may recognize him from a video that went viral when he spoke firmly about the COVID pandemic and the response coming from that city commission. Representative Hardy, thank you for joining us. How are you today?
I'm okay. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
The pleasure is ours. Before we talk about the clip that went super viral, I want to talk about what's happening in Florida right now. Rebecca and I both are from Florida. Matter of fact, I think you and I went to rival high schools. Yeah, I went to Ely High School and you went to Dillard High School, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we all have our roots there. And what's really concerning to us is how Ron DeSantis is rolling out the vaccines, or better yet, withholding some vaccines, and the plan, the strategy, and the impact that it's having, particularly on Black communities. Can you speak to what you're witnessing from your vantage point as a state representative?
Well, you know, to the extent that the governor thinks at all about what he does before he does it, Black people have been an afterthought to him and the people in his orbit. Right now, the vaccination rate among eligible African Americans in my county is about half that of the vaccination rate for eligible white residents. And that is an improvement from the situation a few weeks ago. And rather than recognizing that there's an issue here that he has to address, the governor is holding press conferences boasting about not having a plan, talking about how it's better for Florida not to have a plan. And so it's just very unfortunate to see this situation folding out. Black people have obviously been hit hard on the front side of this pandemic, overrepresented in the hospitalizations, overrepresented in the deaths. And as we're coming out of this thing, we're underrepresented in the vaccination rate, right? And so basically, the governor doesn't care that Black people will be the last people to get sick from this virus and the last people to die from it in Florida because of his lack of leadership. And that's just extremely troubling.
The fact that DeSantis is able to get away with this level of incompetence and actually brag about this incompetence, because for any governor during a pandemic to say that there is no plan, it just reeks of mediocrity, and it reeks of a level of privilege that no one else could ever get away with, especially if you were a Black male governor. If Andrew Gillum had won that race, there's absolutely no way this same party, DeSantis and his Republican Party, would tolerate not having a strategy that effectively covered as many people with vaccinations. What is the response then from the leaders of various communities to this type of incompetence leading that state at such a critical turning point when we have vaccinations? But if we don't get ahead of these variants that are going around, DeSantis can actually help kill tens of thousands more Floridians.
Well, you know what? The response has varied based on who you are, right? So lots of people on the ground are completely and utterly shocked, befuddled by what Governor DeSantis is and is not doing. But the closer you are to power, the more likely you are to be silent about his lack of leadership. And so, you know, I just think it's very important that we push back on what the governor is saying. We can't hear a governor of the third largest state in America. We have 20 million people here, 20+% of our residents are seniors. We cannot accept that our governor does not have a plan. When he says something like that, we can't argue over whether what he says is true. It's obviously not true. The question is, how should we respond to that? That's the only argument that we should be having right now.
Yes, I mean, you're totally right, Representative Hardy. And it's funny because you're from my hometown, or you represent my hometown of West Palm Beach, Florida. And there's a lot of things that are out there that we've been questioning for a long time. So it's great to have you as a representative out there. When you see DeSantis do DeSantis, however we say his name, because look, DeSantis, want to make sure I get it right. But when we see him doing these things and literally stopping the community from moving forward by giving everybody access to these COVID-19 vaccinations and things like that, Black people are at the bottom of the barrel when it comes to all of these, a lot of states. It's not only down there in South Florida, but, you know, what are things that you're doing now in the moment to try to get people to, you know, respond better or to acknowledge it? And are you getting any pushback around you?
Yeah, well, look, you know, to the extent that I have an opportunity to do so, I call out the governor on his failure to do right by Black people. I'll just give you one example. We were able to secure about 500 vaccines, which is a small amount, but not insignificant. I mean, you're talking about 500 lives here for the Black community here in West Palm Beach. We brought those vaccines to a church in the Northwest community. And we were not able to close that event to people just in the community. So what ended up happening was that you had people come from all over the county, people who are never in that community, come to get a vaccine. Now, contrast that with what happened in Manatee County on the West Coast, where Governor DeSantis brought in vaccines. He brought them into particular gated communities that happened to be built in by the developer who's a donor of his, and he closed those distribution sites
to
people from outside of that community. So if you weren't in those communities, if you weren't in those zip codes, you did not have access to those vaccines, right? And so you see what happens when you bring vaccines into the Black community, and you see what happens when you bring vaccines to affluent white communities that are owned and developed by your wealthy donors. There's a disparate treatment right now in the Glades. There's a vaccination site in Pahokee, and it is not closed. You can come in from anywhere in the county to this majority Black neighborhood, this majority Black community, and get vaccines. But in other cases, we've seen them close to people who are on the outside. It's the disparate impact. It's the disparate treatment. You have to call it out. You have to point it out.
Wow.
You have to control people.
Can I?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I just want him to highlight something that I just, so in the Black communities, just to make, put a fine point on this, in predominantly Black communities, the sites are open and people can come from anywhere and get a vaccine. But in these well-to-do, probably affluent white communities, they close the doors, they put the gates up, and you can't come get it. And we're talking, you're already talking about a small amount of vaccinations in the first place that these Black communities are getting. Are we literally seeing, like, what's the breakdown? Like, is there a study yet about the breakdown in those two different scenarios, in the open setting for vaccines in Black communities and the closed setting? I'm just wondering how many people from outside of the communities are snatching up these vaccines away from the Black community. So is there any numbers on that yet?
Yes. So I would really like to see that granular data. You know, the fact of the matter is the vaccine event that, you know, I was a part of, I can tell you that there were probably about 200 or so people out of the 500 vaccines who came from outside of the community to get it. And, you know, this is just how it is in Florida. I mean, the governor, again, when he came to Palm Beach County shortly after Christmas, he came to Kings Point, which is in South County. Majority white community in a gated community, held a press conference, brought vaccines in, and those vaccines were available only to people in Kings Point. But when he went to, again, Pahokee a few weeks ago, you know, people can come from all over to get those vaccines. So it's just a tragedy. And it, again, just goes to show that he's not really thinking about us, right? So he rolls out these plans to the extent that we can call them plans. The plans leave Black people out in the cold. Black people cry out for fairness. And then he scrambles and responds with these press conferences and these one-time events here or there. And even then, the events are not close to the community. When we had a follow-up event for vaccine distribution after, you know, the one I did in the church in the Northwest community here in West Palm Beach, we had to keep it on a low. We were not making any announcements. We're not putting anything on social media. You know, we had to go, you know, pretty much strictly by, you know, word of mouth and shoe leather to make sure that the people who got those vaccines who were notified of it were only the people from those communities. It shouldn't have to be that way. There are obvious steps that the governor could take to prevent that from happening, but he's simply not doing it because he doesn't care.
Yeah. And it, so there are a lot of things that he's not doing. Now that's one part, that's COVID-19. And we see him not doing what he needs to do. And I'm pretty sure there are a long list of things. I know there, while we were in the green room, we were discussing how he is trying to make protesting something that's illegal. Can you speak on that?
Well, look, we have 99 problems in Florida. Protesting is not one of them. We have people lining up for miles to get food because if they don't get it, they're going to go hungry. We have people who still haven't gotten their unemployment benefits, even though they've applied for them. In some cases now, almost a year ago, we have children who have basically lost a year of their education. We have businesses, small businesses that have been shuttered. And the governor's response to all of this is to ignore it, to not propose any legislation to fix our broken unemployment system, to not give any direct aid to small businesses or to human beings who are not corporations. His response to this is to propose legislation to attack our First Amendment rights, to attack the Black Lives Matter movement, to restrict voting rights. And now we have a bill to basically limit the Bright Futures program, which if you're from Florida, you know, is a lifeline for many people. One of the only ways that they can be able to afford higher education. And so this is what we're seeing. Look, this is the most important legislative session that we're about to go into starting on Tuesday, probably the most important legislative session in the history of the state. We have people who are struggling to survive. And the only thing that the governor has saw fit to do is throw red meat to his base as he prepares to run for president. I think it's despicable. I think it's disgusting. And I think it just goes to show that he doesn't give a damn about people in Florida who serve him. And, you know, a lot of people who are elected to, you know, to office, you know, you have to walk a fine line because you might not want to get on the governor's side. You might need the governor's cooperation to, you know, do what you can do for your people. But the fact of the matter is my silence cannot be bought for crumbs. And my people are going to end up getting sick and dying from this disease. And they're losing their jobs, and whatever wealth they had is being rapidly eroded and destroyed. We can't let this happen without saying something about it.
No, I'm right with you. I felt all of it, you know, so not giving a damn to the people getting crumbs. I felt all of it. And I think that West Palm Beach, because I've never seen, we've had some good leaders, but in my, you know, lifetime where I'm able to understand, partner with, it's good to know that we have somebody out there in West Palm Beach, because that's where my mama and my daddy at. And to have somebody out there who's fighting for things that I speak about every day, but you're right there on the ground. You see it going on and you're speaking up for it. And I really, really appreciate that.
And you've been speaking up for COVID and the reaction and the response from these leaders who have a responsibility to provide for the people in these crisis situations. You've been speaking up on it for a very long time, since the beginning of the pandemic. I want to play a portion of the clip where I first discovered your voice. And I think as we play it, I think a lot of people are going to recognize it because it was very powerful. It was powerful at the time. Let's play that clip.
Can we do better? There's always things that pop up that we can do better on, and I call the question.
I'm sorry, that's not how this works. We each have an opportunity to speak 5 minutes.
I thought we did.
Yeah, the question's been called.
I'm sorry.
We've been.
And that's not how calling the question works. You need a second, and you need to vote on.
Then I have a second for calling.
So, are you telling me that you're going to keep me from talking right now?
You've talked all evening.
Look, here. You're calling me disrespectful because I've interrupted people, but this gentleman has turned off people's lights in the middle of a global health pandemic. That's what that gentleman did.
Point of order.
And you think I'm disrespectful for interrupting?
Point of order.
This gentleman has had the ability to do any number of things. We could have banned large gatherings. We could have closed the beach. We could have put a moratorium on utility cutoffs.
I recessed.
Also not within your power, and the attorney has held that that's true.
I recessed the meeting.
Oh, listen, I remember this like it was yesterday.
Rules at the beginning of the meeting, and then you didn't even want to follow the rules that you came up with.
And you took advantage.
This is a banana republic is what you're turning this place into with your so-called leadership.
Does a recess mean that we will be...
Yes.
I don't care anything about this. We should have been talking about this last week.
Can we?
We cut off people's utilities this week and made them pay what could have been their last check to us to turn their lights on in a global health pandemic. But you don't care about that. You didn't want to meet.
It's in my shining
eyes. But every other year, you go around and beg people for their votes.
Can we explain the
reason? You care more about your relationship with that guy than you care about the relationship with the people who don't go to work in this building.
Point of order. You are done. You are done.
Girl, he been done.
She had no idea.
It's disrespectful is what you've done to the working people in the city.
I didn't do anything.
Come on.
You failed to act.
I didn't do anything.
When you're a leader, you failed to act. You said you didn't do anything. You failed to act.
Omari,
when you had an opportunity.
She wasn't done.
don't care anything about that. I think anybody cares.
Does a recess mean that we can reconvene tonight?
Yeah. They try to figure out what do we do?
This black man went off. Can we speak, sir? Look, seriously.
Does this mean we can go eat lunch? That's
because I've been hungry. Listen, when I watch that, I feel that passion like nobody's business. Listen, I understand and I know you were at the point, especially we have to understand that the beginning of that pandemic, you know. When we watched, and I know you watching what was happening to your people, you felt like, how are we doing this? And these people are sitting here acting like nothing's going on. We can just recess. We can just do this. When people were literally dying, people had no lights, people didn't have no food. I felt that passion. And I couldn't imagine going back to the beginning of the pandemic and the government and the people surrounding us and our leaders not wanting to assist us. So us seeing you do that, that gave us some kind of light. That was real, and I appreciate that. My God.
You know, thank you. Lake Worth is 10 minutes from Mar-a-Lago, but it's the second poorest city in Palm Beach County.
Talk about
and
it.
Our residents, if anybody was going to go through it, the residents of Lake Worth Beach were going to go through it. And what you saw in that clip, that was 3 years condensed into 3 minutes. So we had had all these skirmishes over the past 3 years about whether or not we were going to treat our working class residents like they were our constituents, too. But that moment and what was happening there, the tremendous amount of uncertainty and the anguish that people were feeling, it was too much for me. And I had filed about 5 months before that to run for office. And I went home with my then girlfriend, who's now my wife. And we were like, it's over. We were like, it's done. You got me on video yelling at this white lady.
It's over.
You gotta be careful yelling at these Karens, man. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
And I was struggling. You know, I don't know if you noticed, but at the end of the video, when she walked out the room, in my head, I was like, you know, normally I would walk out of that door, but I could not go into that room with her because, as bad as the optics already were, the idea of me, you know, chasing down this white lady in this other room, that was why I stood there.
Yeah.
You know, it was, man.
That was an excellent call.
That was
you
the first
understand.
Thing we probably all saw. Like, yeah, no, I was that like, was he good. Better not go behind that lady.
don't go. but I love that she actually thought that you were done. I appreciate that you thought that you were done because of the sincerity of the moment. But me doing this kind of work, as soon as that was over, I would have been like, oh no, we about to blow, because speaking truth to power in that way, in that moment with that passion at the beginning of the pandemic was exactly what everybody needed to hear. And so it's just so funny. She thought you were done because, you know, now you are on the ascent. Like you are able to impact these issues at a greater level in your position as a state representative and beyond that. So we only have a few moments left here, but tell the people like what you want them to focus on in terms of your work and how they can support you in what you're doing.
Well, look, we need leaders in state government in every state in America who are going to be unapologetic about their advocacy for the community. And when we get these leaders, they can't be alone, right? And so, you know, we need more progressives in state legislatures across the country, because it makes it easier for us to operate. When you get progressives in the legislature, it's almost like you're out on an island. And so if you want us to be effective, we have to be elected in numbers. Find someone in your community. If you want to help me, find someone who's a progressive in your community to get elected to office, so that they don't have the moments that I just had a year ago on that city commission, or the moments that we're likely to have in the state legislature coming up. We need to be in places of power in numbers. That's what we need.
Yes.
That's what we need.
Look, because Ben, you heard me coming in.
Hey.
No, one last thing, Rep. I just wanted to point out that, yes, Ben, she thought you were done, or you thought you were done. But the fact that she thought,
that's the funny part.
She thought when she said she was done that it's you were going to be done, but you were like, listen, no one's going to shut me down. No one's going to shut me up. And that's exactly the kind of quality black representatives that we need in these spaces. And you did that. And you are on ascent. You are going to, especially when you come on platforms like this, you know, everybody needs to follow you, which we're going to get your information soon. But Ben, get that point in. I see that you want to.
No. It just dawned on me, like, how well do you, because we just had state senator, former state representative Chevron Jones on the show last Friday. I'm pretty sure you guys are connected well. And those are the type of people, like, you're right. Yeah. We got to send up the reinforcements for you guys.
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And Senator Jones and I actually have a bill together.
Awesome. Could you tell us about the bill? Yeah.
It's on urban gun violence, right? And so, you know, obviously when people think of gun violence, unfortunately, we think about the mass shootings that make the news, captivate, you know, the national attention, right? But urban gun violence is unfolding every single day. And we're not focused on how to make sure that people's needs are provided for so that these tragic incidents aren't happening, right? And so Senator Chevron Jones and I have a bill to focus the state's attention on addressing this problem in an intelligent, evidence-based way that's not based on people's talking points and politics.
Well, that sounds like that's another necessary thing that people ain't focused on, but you are, and that's very important. Before we get out of here, Representative Hardy, could you let people know where they can find you, where they can follow you, the website, any information that they need?
Yeah, so you can follow me on Twitter at Omari J. Hardy, and you can follow me on Instagram at Omari Hardy, and my website is omarihardy.com. Look, I worked really hard to put my issues out there. You know, I visit my website, omarihardy.com, and you can see the vision that I have for the state of Florida. A better Florida is possible, but we need people with imagination and conviction and courage to pursue these things.
Oh, right there. And with that being said, a better Florida is possible. Bubba, take us a break. We'll be back right after this.
Southern California, it's where the people came to play.
Ladies and gentlemen, make sure that you download the Voices by Action Sprout app so you can be connected with Like It or Not, y'all.
Come and see what you've been missing on a little slice of heaven. It's the only place for
you. Shout out to everybody that's in the chat room that's checking us out. Make sure that you are hitting that like button. And special thanks again to Representative Omari Hardy. We greatly appreciate your work, sir. Keep it up. Thank you so much.
It's been turning kind of gray in Southern California. But I'm alert to the rain. What happened to euphoria?
Priscilla, good morning. Definitely shout out to the moms for keeping the chats under control. We appreciate you. Chuck Diesel, what's up, brother? They want to see my face a little bit.
You better leave me alone. I miss you, but I'm sick and tired of the.
Here I am, y'all. There y'all go.
I don't know why. Just know that I do. Ooh, ooh.
Shout out to everybody that's in the chat room. We appreciate the love, y'all. Make sure that you hit the like button.
It makes me want to scream and shout. You left me hanging down and out. I think you never leave me, but you cheated and deceived me. You never can for me.
Lisa Noel, Lisa, we love y'all. Bubba Lish is really y'all.
So good for you.
Barwell, show thyself, James.
I'm gonna pack my bags, I'll walk out the door. I won't be back. You'll see
Danny,
me
I see you, sir.
No. You better leave me alone.
Let me do something right quick. Here we go, y'all. Y'all ready?
I'm sick and tired of loving you. Don't know why. Just know that I do.
I got the world.
I knew that if y'all we dropped the camera, I knew if we dropped the camera on our next guest that she would be dancing, because what else would Francesca Fiorentini be doing? Francesca is an American journalist, a political commentator and comedian, and she is also the host of a podcast. Rebecca, what's the name of the podcast?
The podcast is called Dun Dun Dun, The Bituation Room. Okay, the Bituation Room. Let's say it with your chest. The Bituation.
I'm not
going to
say it.
Bituation.
I'm not going to say it because somebody's going to clip just that the first part of it and say Ben called somebody that. So that said, Francesca, thank you for joining us. I know it is super early over there.
Oh yeah, no, but at 7 a.m. I do wake up like that, just gonna. I don't know what he was saying, but it sounded like he was gaslighting a woman. He was gonna leave a woman. There was a little bit of gaslighting in that song. I'm not gonna lie.
A little bit.
Great song still. Right?
You're not supposed to listen to the lyrics. You're just supposed to vibe and not realize they're talking about. it's almost like Earth, Wind & Fire Reasons. Like you start listening to what they say in some of those songs, you're like, wait a minute, I don't know if I agree with this.
Here he go again with his misogyny. Here he go again, and I love this song, but here he go thinking that she ain't gonna be. Listen, yeah I get it.
Yeah. So Francesca, first of all, thank you so much for joining us.
I'm batting cleanup. You guys have fixed everything, right? You've solved and hashed out it all, and.
Well, the only thing we solved is our internet connectivity problems today. But the problems with America, we have yet to solve. And I don't know that it's going to get solved in our lifetime. But yet and still, we do this. And I wonder if you do this through comedy to help you like kind of process the kind of stupidity that we have to deal with.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's if, I had a dinky internet show. Now I have a still dinky internet show. My life is dinky internet shows. But the point is my very first was something called Laugh Not to Cry. And it was just me in a green screen. Not too different from, again, what you're seeing now. But you have to laugh in order not to cry. And I think especially as progressives, people on the left, we get into trouble when we start taking everything so seriously. And then it's like you've crossed this, like, yeah, even just a personality Rubicon where you're like, oh, I hate myself. everything's really real. We should take things seriously. But like, you know, understand the stakes, but also be able to laugh and be able to laugh at ourselves more than anything.
Yeah, yeah. That's honestly why we're doing what we're doing in the way that we're doing it, because as we cover the news from Syria to everywhere else to the $15 an hour, we'll talk about that in a minute. It gets to you. So sometimes you do have to laugh for not crying. And I vaguely remember that series. I want to ask you, let's talk about the fact that we can't even get $15 an hour. Right. In the year of our Lord 2021, when the minimum wage should be somewhere around $25 an hour, we are being gaslit. Speaking of gaslighting, beautiful song. Right. The gaslighting that was taking place there. I feel like we're getting gaslit by Joe Biden and some of our leaders. What's your take on this $15 an hour parliamentarian issue?
Yeah, no, I love when progress is held up by someone you didn't even know existed, you know, just like some random rule. I don't know. It's very much like, I don't know. It's like you go to a restaurant and they're like, oh no, we have mozzarella sticks, but like we're out of, I don't know, the cook is on a break. And you're like, okay, well, can someone else make them? I don't know. I'm thinking of a very silly example, but it's almost, it's just a technicality. It's like, I just watched Ford versus Ferrari and remember how he wins, but he comes in second because of a technicality. And I was like, it's just what is this parliamentarian doing? And why could we overrule them when Trump wanted to pass a $2 trillion tax plan? Because that's exactly what happened. Basically, they were, you know, Republicans were like, oh, parliamentarian says we can't use budget reconciliation to, you know, push through this tax break and try to chip away at the ACA, which is what they wanted to do. Okay, we're just gonna override you. I mean, we don't care. I don't even think it was a news item. We didn't even hear about that because it was one of the, you know, at that point, like the 30th, you know, norm and rule and regulation that the Trump administration had skirted. Now, I'm not saying we repeat that. Of course, if we were on MSNBC, someone would be like, well, we shouldn't be like Trump, but we should when it comes to passing a $15 minimum wage. We absolutely should in the middle of a pandemic.
In the middle of a pandemic. Go ahead.
You said something totally like, okay, this is my thing. Trump is still trash. That doesn't change anything, right? But he was onto something right there. The fact that they can't even pass $15 for us means that the people still mean nothing. Biden had, you know, like I said, he ran his campaign with the whole guise of I'm that guy. I'm that man. You know, I'm the one that can protect you guys from what you guys had before. Yep. I'm your grandfather. I'm your friend. I'm the one that was right beside Barack Obama. And literally he gets in office after he's saying he's going to do these things immediately and listen to us. And he's just like, listen, I'm still that guy, but I'm not going to do that for you. Can I still get love? Can I still? But it's like, so yeah. So this is, so when you say things like, $15 an hour under Trump, all of those things, that would have worked for us better than what is being proposed to us now. Right. That's real. And this is where our mindset should be, is holding them accountable, but also saying, yo, those policies, those rules, those plans are things that can work for us. We can still utilize that. No matter who it came from, we got to be honest. You know, we got to say that works better for the people. And what we're getting now from just because a likable person, it's BS. It's BS.
Gaslighting. Democrats love to play by these random parliamentarian rules in a party, in a system that basically has been set up for one party to completely skirt those rules, and a bad faith party like the Republicans to completely skirt those rules. And then when Democrats are in power, they're like, oh no, but we've got to abide by them. And it's almost like they also are paid by the same lobbyists and don't really want to help the working class out. But hey, you know, that's, I'm not going to say that they're paid to lose necessarily, but or they're exact same. They're not. The other thing is, I do think, look, Kamala Harris was chosen as vice president for a reason. And this is a moment where she needs to pull her. I was that little girl who was sent to school, you know, who was bused to school. Mm-hmm. And your policies affected me. Kamala needs to pull that, because actually the vice president does have a role to play in this budget reconciliation. She can step out and overrule this parliamentarian BS. I don't know if you guys had already talked about that, but I'm like, do it, Kamala. Like, this is the point. The point is not just to be a smiling face. You're not the Joe Biden of vice presidents. You know what I mean? Like,
not
you
in don't this just moment.
You don't do the pancake breakfasts and, you know, just smile and have your, you know, your daughter be a model, or your stepdaughter be a model. Like, it just, no, do something, be a leader. And we want to see that. I think, you know.
Listen, no, Francesca, you are here, you are in the house, and I'm feeling it, mama. Listen, I've been saying this for the last few days all week. Kamala, let me make sure I get it right. Kamala, ma'am, sis, listen, I get it. Like I said, you're Black. I get it. You wear Tims and Chucks. I get it, right? I get it. You are an HBCU grad. That's stuff that I love, right? I get it. You crossed AKA. It's beautiful. In this moment, ma'am, this is the people that need you. Yeah. There are people that need you, that need you to speak up. This is the time, because you too, just like Joe Biden, ran your campaign on these things that you said you were going to do, and we don't see anything. Ma'am, you've been missing. Texas has been like, there's a state out there that was literally under snow where people were dying, freezing to death. This was literally happening. Where were you? Where are you guys? Kamala, we literally put you on a cloud, ma'am, and you are nowhere to be found at all. Pull up, ma'am. Pull up.
I'm actually really surprised. Sorry, on the Texas thing. Like, you guys have talked about that no one from the administration, I mean, neither the president or vice president have been there. And that's like, ugh. You're right. It's a perfect opportunity for Vice President Harris to show some leadership and to get there and to do the things that it feel like. If Biden, stay home, I don't care. But like, get on an Amtrak. You could beat the storms. Get there.
He can take the train. He loves riding that train. The thing about it is like we're in this, it's not a weird space for you, me, Rebecca, but it's a weird space for well-meaning Democrats who are like, we can't possibly criticize Joe Biden. It's too early on. Well, Joe Biden is making some moves pretty early on. Donald Trump didn't do his first airstrike until, was it April? Joe Biden beat the curve. He's doing it already in February. So we can't afford to not bring these valid criticisms to the people who took our votes, right? And now they're reneging on all their deals that they promised us. But what do you, in terms of like your commentary and your space and what you do, are you running into the same thing? Because when Rebecca mentioned that the other day, Rebecca, I don't know if you saw the comments, people were like, oh, leave Kamala alone. No.
Didn't look at it, but I already knew it was there. That's why I say, I'm going to make y'all mad. But this is the truth of the matter. Where is she? She ain't helping you, sis. She ain't helping none of y'all. Talk about it.
I mean, I'm still in my home and I wish I could interact more with people. And I think if I could, I would definitely not talk politics with them right now because I just want to hang. But
yeah, I get it.
For sure, there is a lot of like, we've restored the dignity. And like, we all know, like this, I think we have. And I think some Democrats understand this. For sure, the squad does. For sure, you know, folks like AOC, Ayanna Pressley, et cetera. But like Schumer, he said things like we need to deliver big for the American people or else. But this is the thing. We have 4 years to stop a smarter fascist, whether it's Trump or somebody else, from saying, look, the Democrats didn't deliver. And the way that they can is by stymieing progress like this. Republicans can. And this has been their plan all along, ever since under Obama, right? And we know that. And Obama, again, playing by these bipartisan rules that did not apply, especially when that was the year that dark money was flooding into this Congress, right? And flooding in all these interests, the AstroTurf Tea Party movement. So when are we going to understand the other side does not want to hold hands with you? They don't want to discuss or deal with you. You're not going to say anything that's going to make them try to, you know, to be, okay, hey, that's a good deal. No, they don't want any of that, right? And then same with our side, right? You've got Manchin and Kristen Sinema. So if you can override this, do it. Because guess what? When you deliver for the American people, when, by the way, there was a New York Times article that said Trump voters like the $1.9 trillion stimulus. Trump voters are into that much money, right? And so the jury isn't out. The Republican politicians, guess what? They are out of touch with their base because that fake populism that Trump tapped into, that could be real populism, right? That could be real Democratic reforms. You know, and so I think that we've got this time. We've got this like grace, not even grace period. We've got no grace period. Right. But we've got this minimal window to say, let's deliver for the American people so we can prevent actual fascism from coming back. Because you know people are chomping at the bit to deliver that. And, you know, if Biden wants to be the most progressive president since FDR, then you got to think bigger than that. You got to think bigger than, well, I don't think this is going to pass because of the the parliamentarian. at what point has anyone used the word parliamentarian to discuss like American democracy?
At what point has that ever been an impediment for any serious president, right? The thing about it is, there's a clip that we have from Ro Khanna, and there are a handful of people who are pushing back against this. And most of them are the progressives, right? Honestly, I think it's probably all progressives. AOC spoke out against it. I saw Jamal Bowman. I saw Ilhan Omar, Ayanna Pressley. All of them spoke out about it. And I want to play this clip from Ro Khanna so that we can see what he had to say about it.
The standalone bill is not going to go through, as Joe put it, a do-nothing Republican Senate. We have to still work to get this through reconciliation. Look, we're in an amazing place in American democracy. The 32 million Americans are being denied a raise because of a decision of an unelected parliamentarian. She has an incredible integrity. She's not to blame. The problem is the system. And there are progressives who believe that the vice president should do the same thing that Vice President Rockefeller did, Vice President Humphrey did, in not accepting the advice of the parliamentarian. So we believe we need to still push for systemic reform to get this through.
So he's not by himself, right? There's plenty of people who are saying the same thing. You've said it this morning. We've said it this morning. The question is do you think Kamala's going to actually do something about this?
No. That's all I got for you. And the only reason that I say no is because what has she... We already know her history. And a lot of people, just like I said, we did the Obama thing when it came to Kamala. We looked at her and said she was Black. And that was enough for us to, and she's a woman, which those are beautiful things. And those are historical. But historical things are not going to help us right now during this pandemic. It's not going to help the nation right now when it comes to these social injustice issues. That ain't helping, sweetie. So we need her to step up in this role as we thought that she would because she was Black because she's Native American. Any one of those, like, we thought that she was going to step into that. But there's so much more. We have to keep holding her accountable. And people keep saying, she's just the vice president. She's the vice president.
This is her shine.
This is a job, sis. We didn't just want her because she was cute. We didn't just want her because the way she was like, we did it, Joe. That was cute, viral, but we need you to do the work. She has a job to do. She has sure. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's a little bit racist and sexist to say, now she's just the vice president. Her race and her gender are super important when she's running. Oh, yeah. Add that to Joe Biden. But if you only saw her as for her race or for her gender and not for her record, you know, some of which is not great when it comes to progressives, but like her tenacity in the Senate, her leadership, her ability to step to someone like Joe Biden on a national stage, like, that's why you want her as your running mate. That's why you want her in the office. You need her to prop this, you know, weekend at Bernie's, i.e. I wish it was Bernie, president up, you know, like, we need her leadership for sure.
that would take some serious, and I think she has it, right? Because, I mean, let's think about back in the debates. She was the first person to really stand up and give Joe Biden hell then. And if Joe Biden is going to continue to use this excuse, this is where Kamala can distinguish herself as an individual, as a politician, and as a leader to say, I have my own authority. And this is the exact spot for this authority to shine. I don't want to harp on that story alone, but it's a really important one because this is going to actually pave the way for Democrats to get demolished in 2022, right? And get devastated. Donald Trump might actually get reelected in 2024 because Republicans haven't gotten rid of him. So speak to just the idiocy of the strategy, right? Like the using this excuse is literally going to be detrimental to the Democratic Party. If all they're worried about is power, this is a move that's going to damage their power. Meanwhile, I don't know if you saw the video, Pete Buttigieg they're putting videos of him up because he's riding his bike to his office instead of doing a car ride to his office. Nobody cares about that. People need checks and they need $15 an hour.
Biking, you know, the thing that was invented, I think, you know, and like with that fad in like the 70s, you know, it's like, it reminds me of like Anchorman's jogging, like, oh, suddenly... Jogging's good for the heart. Oh, biking is good for the climate. Like, really? Really? What year are we in? Like, we're beyond, we all need to bike to work. We're way beyond that. So, yeah, I mean, I will say, though, I don't want to talk about Kamala too much, but I do just want to say that if Biden is supposed to be a transitional president, supposedly to Kamala's eventual run at the White House, then she should and she needs to stand out. She needs to show leadership because if people are going to rally around her, either in 4 or 8 years, she needs to have something to show for that. She needs to say, actually, I pushed this president when you thought I wouldn't, or when he said, you know, A, I said B and we came to C, or whatever it is. Yeah. Like that's going to be super important for her. You know, if she doesn't want AOC to, you know, run against her and probably win, we'll see. But I keep on going back to when, you know, Democrats had Congress and they used, you know, a technicality basically to pass the ACA, the Affordable Care Act. And I think my problem with that was not the fact that they used a technicality or that they barely, you know, slimly pushed that through. It's that the ACA was crap. It's that, I mean, it's helped a lot of people, but it did not have a public option. And I don't know about anyone listening, but I'm paying through the nose for healthcare on the marketplace. It is expensive. It is a luxury item. It's a lot of money. And I'm on the bronze, you know, like I'm not even silver.
Girl, you on the bronze? Wow.
Yeah. You got money.
You got money. You ordered a double, girl?
There's like a corrugated metal, you know, there's like corrugated roof. There's tin, copper, you know, what else? It's not easy to get healthcare. And what I'm saying is that if we had not bent the rules, but used a technicality to pass something that was really transformative, like I think a $15 minimum wage would be transformative, then that is what I think we need to fight for. The problem with the ACA was that once they got rid of the single payer option, a lot of the movement, the social movement that was supporting Obama, was like, oh, okay. And a lot of the movement around the single payer healthcare plan, it didn't rally the base. And so you've got to give the base something. Don't just use us when it's convenient, man. Like give us something so we can come out, so we can like go to bat for you, so we can show up for you if you want us to show up for you.
Mm. And that's a point, because we have nothing to show up. We really, at this point, if people want us to show up for Biden and Kamala, as we did when they were campaigning, and folks like me who was just like, I don't want to, but I need to, because this is going to be a better opportunity. And what he's saying and what they're promising is going to help me. So at this point, I'm like, what else can I do? What else can I say? I can't, because you guys are not giving us anything to work with. You're not showing us anything. You're not allowing us to rally around folks to get them to understand why they should be supporting you. Because it ain't like, if it was about the $15, that could be something, that could be a conversation I have with family members who were doubting what you were going to do or anything. If it was about the stimulus check, that could be something I had a conversation with people who were doubting you. But I ain't got nothing. And where's Waldo? Where is Kamala Harris? We just, at this point, there's nothing that we can say at this particular point in this particular week on this Good Friday. There's nothing that I can say to support those two at this moment.
Yeah. And that's going to be the kicker, Fran. That the kicker is that we literally, in less than a month or however many days they've been in there, now no longer have any reason to support them, except for those people who are comfortable saying, well, he's not Donald Trump. I get it. He's not Donald Trump. I voted against Donald Trump. I voted for Biden because we need to get rid of Donald Trump. But I mean, you got to give us something. We don't have a check. We don't have we're dropping bombs in Syria, by the way. We don't have $15 an hour. And now we're using all these excuses. Fran, we only have a few minutes here, and I want you to get the last word on this particular topic. But like, at what point, man, are these folks going to actually realize that they need the people? Right. I think Democrats feel like all they need to do is not be Republicans. But that jig is up.
Yeah. I mean, it's sad to say this, but, and maybe people will be mad at me for saying it, but I feel like, just like I think Democrats have to rise above some of the Republican BS and kind of be the better person and or fight like them. I think when it comes to the Democratic Party, progressives always have to handhold. You know, it's the way that, you know, women have to handhold men, people of color have to handhold white people, like, but they shouldn't. Mm-hmm. They shouldn't have to. But there's a lot of handholding that needs to happen, because at the end of the day, we need these establishment do-nothing Democrats to actually do something. Like, we don't have yet a system where we can outnumber them, where we can strong-arm them. We don't have an actual parliamentarian system that, man, I wish we had, you know?
Oh, come on,
where, you know, the squad could be in its own party. And then we could see who's captivating the audiences, who's bringing out the voters, right? Because, you know, it's not the centrists, you know, it's the grassroots people of color. It's, you know, we know who has actually done this. So I think we have to not imagine that we've already asked. We have to make sure, and there are people fighting every day. There are people out on the streets, you know, whether it's around a Green New Deal and the Sunrise Movement, whether it's Justice Democrats, whether it's Fight for 15 and all of the, you know, the fast food workers who consistently and have been leading this charge for so many years now, to the point where, again, it should be 20, 25. But these are the folks we have to be lifting up and making sure, you know, that we're continuing to call on them and we're continuing to knock down their doors. You know, we're supposed to be making calls to, like, you know, voters. We should just make calls right into the White House. I mean, we need calls right into the Congress, right? Like, let's make sure we understand who we're actually pressuring here, because the voters did their job.
The voters did their job. Clip that and put that on. The voters did their job, and now it's time for them to do their jobs. Fran, who do you have coming up on your podcast that I won't say the name? Rebecca, what's the name of the podcast again?
The Bituation Room.
Who do you have coming up this weekend?
A very funny comic, Baron Vaughn, and Alex Vitali, who is a professor, writes all about, like, policing and can they be reformed? What do we do? Why can they not be reformed? Remake them. Mm. So yeah, Alex Vitali and Baron Vaughn, so good. So that's Sunday night, 6 o'clock Eastern. No, 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern. It is seven there in the morning here.
It is 7 in the morning over there. Thank you for getting up so early to hang out with us. Everybody who's watching, please go to her channel and subscribe. And we would love to have you back anytime you want to come.
Oh my gosh, Ben, Rebecca, it's been such a pleasure. Anytime.
Absolutely.
Yes, I love it. So, and then, you know, look, you come on here, I come on to the Bituation Room.
Yes.
We have a good old time. We party it up.
Get somebody over there to say,
we enjoy ourselves. That'll be really good. Francesca Fiorentini. Beautiful name, by the way. And
beautiful pronunciation.
Yeah. And then the last guy, I just want to put this out there because, Ben, I think this will make you laugh. Representative Omari Hardy.
Uh-huh.
Before you got on, I read your name incorrectly. What was it, Monday? I said, Omari Hardway? Oh my God, I am gonna be there. Yes, and I'm gonna be real cute. I cannot wait. Oh, Ben really did that? Yes, that's exactly.
Well, listen, I'm working on plies. I'm working to get plies on the show. I'm working to get a couple folks over here that I think will give you that same reaction. So stay tuned, everybody. Fran, it's always a pleasure. Rebecca. Anything else? James, how you doing over there, man?
That is it.
I'm good.
Everybody good?
So it's Friday. I hope everybody enjoys their Friday. Make sure you guys follow me on Twitter at Rebecca Azor, R-E-B-E-C-C-A-A-Z-O-R. You guys already know how to get up with Ben because he's like that dude on Twitter. But I love you guys. Mean it. I will see you guys Monday morning right here.
Take care, everybody.
Like it or not.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, make sure that you subscribe. And if you want to support and become a patron, you can right here at that link, patreon.com/thebpdshow. Again, patreon.com/thebpdshow. And you can support the show, y'all. It's like it or not. Unfortunately, corporate America is calling my name. So after this song, it's going to be a wrap for us, y'all. Like it or not.
Transparent, you tear down every wall that I built up. Now I wanna let you know that, yeah, everything about you makes me smile.
Shout out to everybody that joined us this morning. Make sure that you hit your like button on the way out.
friend.
And make sure that you subscribe and comment so you always know when Like It or Not is going down.
You don't understand, you don't need to worry. I meant everything I said, you don't have to search no more. Love is all around, so baby, what's your hurry? You don't have to prove us to anyone. You don't need to worry.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that is going to do it for your boy, DJ Exclusive James Lover Williams. I am out, y'all. We will see y'all Monday morning. And as usual, don't forget to download the Voices by Access Proud app so you can become a part of the Like It or Not community. You can use our group code to join. The group code is 213-756. 213-756. Once you are in, you will be able to send us pictures, videos, stories, whatever you may have, and we'll try to get that played on the air, y'all. Again, we thank you for tuning in this week to Like It or Not. Enjoy your weekend, and we will see y'all on Monday. Peace out. All right, so I appreciate it, Dwayne. Oh, shit. Wait a minute. Okay, there we go. Okay. Wait, we still streaming.